We are going to get the proceedings started. I'd like to welcome all of our attendees to this first webinar in a series of four webinars that's being jointly hosted by the Future Climate for Africa program and the Learning Agenda for Climate Information Services in Sub-Saharan Africa. My name is Jean-Pierre Roux. I am a program manager for the Future Climate for Africa program based at South South North in Cape Town, South Africa. If you have an interest in the work of either of these programs, please follow the links on your screen and get in touch with us. So we are very excited to be hosting a series of webinars on this topic at this time, because it appears there has been, I think over the past few years, an acceleration of both intent and actions amongst many global, regional and national actors to operationalize sustainable services, climate information services, to address the needs of African communities vulnerable to extreme weather and climate events. I won't go into too much detail on the broader context, as I think we have a distinguished panel that will set the scene, and we do have quite a tight schedule for today's seminar. By way of introduction, I will say a few words about the webinar series and the forthcoming webinars, particularly with the eye on greater participation of African perspectives. So today's webinar will largely draw on research outputs from a project entitled Assessing the Sustainability and Effectiveness of Climate Information Services in Africa, Sustainable CIS for short, which is part of the US aid program Learning Agenda on Climate Services in Sub-Saharan Africa. And in particular, there we'll be focusing on a soon-to-be published white paper, a CIS market assessment and business model review. We'll then go into a number of private sector actors to showcase some examples of their work and engagement with national Met and hydrological services and other government agencies. And we'll be sharing a few research results from a demand analysis of services to integrate climate information into infrastructure planning and design decisions. Looking ahead to the other webinars in the series, we're planning three further webinars, that one a month for March, April, and May. The second webinar would be looking at understanding capacity needs of national Met and hydrological agencies as the primary providers of weather and climate data and information, and as the organizations mandated to observe and forecast and issue warnings for their respective countries. This webinar will focus on approaches and tools to identify capacity needs in national Met agencies. And the third webinar for April will build on this and follow on to identify particular capacity gaps and recommendations for national and regional training efforts to support national Met and Hydro agencies. And it will showcase some learning from several country case studies, including Malawi, Niger, and Senegal. The fourth and final webinar in the series, scheduled for May, will return to the topic of business models for effective and sustainable CIS delivery, and we'll be discussing a number of options for sustainably financing national Met and hydrological services, particularly looking at implementation of public-private partnerships across Africa, again with a number of case studies to that effect. I think given that this topic is a, I think the questions that we'll be addressing in this series are contested by nature. And I think because of that, we are aware of the value of diverse and representative perspectives. It goes without saying that the African continent, which is geographically the focus of the series, is extremely large and diverse. And although we'll be offering some vignettes today that could give us entry points to wider discussion, we are also aware that there is a lot of expertise at the regional, sub-regional, and national scales. And we would like to give that expertise an opportunity to participate in this webinar series. So we also realize that in many of these discussions, gender-sensitive perspectives are also essential. So I would like to extend an invitation today to all of our attendees. If you are from an African Met agency, a university or research institution, a local NGO, consultancy, or private company, please do get in touch. We are in the process of putting together our panels for the future events, And we would very much like this webinar series to foreground, I think, an inclusive, rich, and diverse exchanges. A few notes on housekeeping for today before I hand over to our speakers. On the general housekeeping for this webinar, we have panelists today who will be presenting a series of lightning presentations of no more than 8 minutes. And as the facilitator, I'll be keeping them strictly to time. We'll only be exchanging questions and answers after all the presentations have been made. I'm asking attendees to submit questions via the Q&A button and not via the chat. If you have any technical difficulties, you can submit that via the chat interface. But please submit any questions via the Q&A button, which should be at the bottom of your Zoom webinar interface. Please also note the particular panelist to whom you would like to address the question. As the facilitator, I'll be screening the questions and relaying them verbally to the panelists. We'll aim to answer as many questions as possible in the allotted time. We have about a half an hour allocated to Q&A. Whatever we can't answer live, we will answer in writing following the event. Last but not least, this webinar is being recorded, and we'll be sharing it on the Future Climate for Africa YouTube channel. So please consider sharing it with anyone you may know or who you'd like to view it but couldn't attend today. So without further delay, I'll give a brief introduction to our panelists today and their presentations. First off, we have Mr. Dimitar Ivanov. He's chief of the World Meteorological Organization's Aeronautical Met Division and officer in charge of quality management systems. And he'll be presenting on public-private engagement policy, the WMO's public-private engagement policy. Next, we have Mr. Robert O'Sullivan. He is from Winrock International, and he'll be looking at innovative meteorological early warning systems and public-private partnerships for climate adaptation engagement in LDCs. I beg your pardon, that's Ari Davidov. Robert O'Sullivan will be presenting on climate information services in sub-Saharan Africa, a review of the market and private sector engagement. Next, we have Ari, as noted, presenting on innovative MET and early warning systems and private public-private partnerships. And after that, we have David McAfee. David McAfee is the CEO of Viamo. And he will be presenting on a mobile service, the 321 service, with some experiences there. Last but not least, I'll be giving a brief overview of a study that South-South-North did on analyzing the demand for services, climate information services in the infrastructure sector. So with that, I shall stop sharing my screen and hand over to our first panelist, Dimitar Ivanov.
Thank you, Jean-Pierre, and thanks to all organizers for inviting WMO to present to this webinar. I hope you can hear me well.
I can, loud and clear.
Okay, greetings from Geneva. My talk today is about our recent activities in developing a policy framework for public-private engagement in the provision of weather and climate services. The trigger of these activities was given by the 17th Congress of WMO in 2015 with the realization of the serious ongoing transformative processes, which are briefly annotated as the so-called global weather enterprise. I assume that most of the participants in this webinar know about WMO, but this slide is just a quick reminder that WMO is the UN agency for meteorology, including weather and climate, operational hydrology and related geophysical sciences. We are an intergovernmental organization composed of member states and territories. This is very important to understand when talking about public-private engagement framework, because often WMO is seen as representing the public sector only. In fact, we work closely with our main counterpart in the states, which are the National Meteorological and Hydrological Services, indeed public agencies. However, there is a lot of interaction and coordination with other stakeholders from academia, learned societies, and private sector industry. I'll try to highlight some of the main features of the WMO public-private partnership in this during this 8 minutes time slot. The key message here is that we need to realize a major transformation from a primary public-funded model in all areas of WMO activities, including observations, forecasting services, to an enterprise model with various stakeholders from the three main sectors, public, private, and academia. The main drivers for this transformation include the expectations for enhanced weather and climate information services included in major policy global agenda, including the UN Sustainable Development Goals, the Sendai Framework, the Paris Agreement, and the Global Framework for Climate Services, GFCS. Another major driver is the rapid technology change, which with many game changers along the whole value chain of meteorological services. The increased demand for decision supportive services at all levels to mitigate weather and climate sensitivities. And in addition to that, the pressure on public budgets, which affects the ability of public and MHSs to meet the demands and adapt to the new situation. And of course, changing business models. The policy framework includes some basic principles for successful win-win public-private partnerships scenarios. Among those are the need to define mandates and responsibilities of various actors from the different sectors, to ensure level playing field, the adherence to the international norms and standards promulgated by the WMO, to stimulate uptake of research results into operations and the generation of and sharing of knowledge. And last but not least is the principle, no country left behind, which is very important when we talk about developing world, because the change process is very rapid and maybe disruptive. In applying these principles, we also realize some major challenges. And I put here at first place the challenge of data ownership and data sharing policy. WMO has been promoting a free and open data exchange between its members, and this policy has been the basis of the significant advancement of the global monitoring and forecasting capability in meteorology, hydrology, and climate. However, within the enterprise context, many stakeholders now express the view that the data policies need to be revisited and updated to reflect various business models. Other challenges are linked to the various national legal frameworks. The understanding and need of the notion of authoritative voice when we talk about warnings, early warning systems, information which is part of the disaster risk reduction. In a multiple provider environment, when you can get same or similar information from various sources, there are challenges related to the identification of the source of information, the accountability of the providers, and the need for consistent quality assurance. Finally, there is a national, regional, and global core infrastructure that enables most activities of all sectors. These are observing networks, etc. The cost of the maintenance and modernization of this infrastructure should be appropriately allocated to guarantee its sustainability. Along with the challenges, the public-private partnership offers many new opportunities, in particular, new ways for resolving long-standing deficiencies in the developing part of the world related to the availability and access to critical weather and climate information. And private sector can help to reach end users to promote economic solutions in this regard. WMO is working closely with several major partners in the framework of the Global Weather Enterprise. A series of dialogues has taken place since 2014. The most active players besides WMO in these dialogues are the World Bank and its Global Facility for Disaster Reduction and Recovery, GFDRR, the Association of Hydrometeorological Equipment Industry, HMEI, and learned societies such as the American Meteorological Society and others. During a meeting which was held last November in Washington, D.C., an agreement was reached to establish a small group, tentatively called Global Weather Enterprise Forum, composed by four prominent names from each sector, public from NMHSs, private companies and academia, universities and research centers. This group which is still in a formation stage. We are going to have a first meeting, kickoff meeting on 9 April in Singapore during the Intermed Asia event. This is the group that is expected to provide a consultative mechanism to facilitate, steer, and contribute to the dialogue between the public, private, and academia sectors. And finally, very briefly about our planned major activities and milestones as WMO. We are in a consultation stage with other partners to organize a large-scale conference on the Global Weather Enterprise, most likely in October this year. The aim of this event will be to expand the dialogue with all stakeholders on the main issues which I mentioned before, such as data policy, and to plan concrete actions how to enable the future growth of the weather enterprise. An ultimate goal for us is the next WMO Congress in June 2019. The Congress, as our supreme body, will consider important policy decisions, including the approval of the policy framework for public-private partnership. It is also expected that the Congress will adopt measures for a better representation of the private sector in the WMO decision-making processes. To achieve these goals in the remaining months to Congress, we will be collecting examples of national practices, good and bad, case studies, including case studies that you're conducting in the framework of your project. We will also be looking to work closely with similar frameworks, and we have a particular interest on the developing part of the world, including the sub-Saharan Africa. With this, I conclude my brief presentation of the WMO ongoing activities for enhanced public-private partnership in the context of the Global Weather Enterprise. And I'll be happy to answer questions at the question Q&A session, or you can approach me by email for further information. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Dimitar, for that succinct and useful overview of WMO's efforts to bring together a global framework on this. A repeat for those participants who joined us slightly late. We'll be taking questions and answers once the panelists have completed their presentations, and you can submit your questions via the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. Next, I'll hand over to Robert Sullivan.
Thanks, JP. Dimitar, can you stop sharing so that I can make my presentation live? Perfect. Okay, so thanks for the introduction, JP, and Dimitar, for that excellent framing of what the WMO is doing. And so I'll be presenting some initial findings from some work that is being carried out through a USAID-funded project on sustainable CIS that we're aiming to provide some information to help WMO and others, you know, as they move forward thinking about how to engage the private sector and others in a more sustainable climate information service system in sub-Saharan Africa. So what we did, we started off by looking at taking a step back and looking at the bigger picture of what's the total market for climate information services around the world, and then to try and drill down to see what it is within Africa. And this is where we looked at primarily existing literature to get an understanding of the status quo. So globally, in 2015, the global market was around $56 billion for climate and weather information services. So that's both climate and weather. A bit over half of that was on weather information, 54%. But this global market of $56 billion is not spread evenly. As this slide shows, that the sub-Saharan Africa, which is the focus area of our study, is the smallest share of that. And in addition to it being not evenly spread amongst different countries, there's quite a bit of segmentation within the different parts of an economy. with some areas of an economy having a lot more attention on climate and weather information as opposed to other parts. In sub-Saharan Africa, that is dominated from what we can tell by the ag sector. So turning then to looking at what is actually made up within the climate and weather enterprise within in sub-Saharan Africa. As Dimito was saying, there's within the CWE, there's private sector, public sector, academia, and we were then drilling down into what is the private sector's role within the CWE. You know, the Met Services play a key and foundational role, but we wanted to understand how the private sector is operating. And so we did a number of case studies over a dozen different companies operating in Africa, and mapped out where they each operate within a climate information services data flow or value chain. And you can see here how we broke up the different parts of data generation, analysis, going through the end users. And initially I was anticipating that there would be a domination by the private sector in these areas 4 and 5, the end user dissemination, getting it out to people on the ground. But what was surprising is there was also quite a lot of private sector engagement further up the data flow and value chain, with quite a few companies operating at the observational data and then also the national, regional and local models. But as you can also see that a number of companies operate at multiple points along the data flow. And how they operate was another exercise that we researched. And so from looking at the over a dozen different companies, we broke out, you know, what types of business models they have along that value chain. And I won't go through this table in detail, but highlight so that the B2D, B2D to C refers to business to donor. Here in this case, it's business to government to consumer. And you can see there's a collection of the most dominant types of business models are in this business to business and in the business to consumer. But you can also see here that a number of companies, you know, it's not a matter of one type of business model. They will have a number of different business models to service the growing CIS market within the region. So in the interest of time, just hitting on some of the key conclusions that we have pulled from the market analysis to date. So the first, as should be evident from the last couple of slides, is that there is a very diverse and rich set of business models and ways that the private sector operate within sub-Saharan Africa. And as Dimito was saying, there is, you know, considerable scope for public-private partnerships between the private sector and Met Services. One thing we did observe that in developed countries, developed economies, there has in the past been a sustained dialogue amongst the different actors within the climate and weather enterprise that has helped facilitate those types of PPPs. But as of today, no kind of equivalent host exists within sub-Saharan Africa. Another conclusion that we drew from the market assessment is that while there is certainly a desire from the private sector for PPPs, sometimes there can be a mismatch between the type of information that is most useful and helpful for some of the private sector models and the type of data that's available. And for example, having localized short-term forecasts is an important piece of information if that was freely and publicly available that the private sector could then use for additional services around climate and weather information. But in many cases, the Met Services don't have the capacity to do those localized short-term forecasts. And this brings to another point, which is that the data infrastructure and the underlying investment to create the infrastructure for the climate and weather enterprise is an important foundation that helps then grow the market and make the market bigger. Another important finding is that, you know, linked to this previous one, is that a stable budget and revenue for the Met services is important. And this is particularly important that it's not just a budget to go and buy more and more stuff, but also, you know, there needs to be the right budget for operation and maintenance of the existing infrastructure. And that then helps ensure that the information is being collected, is being processed, and is made available. Another important finding from the work, which is quite an interesting one, is that, you know, on the one hand, a lot of the participants in the market are receiving some level of donor support, and to help catalyze the market and help create the market in the first place, and this is to be expected within the continent. However, there is also some indication that if that donor support or subsidy continues too long, you can end up with a distorting effect that actually ends up dampening competition within a nascent private sector. And here a recommendation is that the donor support is important for catalyzing and creating a broader and richer and more sustainable market, but there also needs to be a clear exit strategy. So that donor support is of the right scale and time frame to get the market going, but then it can't keep on going too long to then create problems of competition within a proper market. Finally, another conclusion that we observed and that was noted in the previous presentation, that is around new technological innovations are coming into the marketplace, and often these are innovations that were developed in developing countries and developing economies. Developed economies, and are being imported and modified for a sub-Saharan context. And I will stop now. Again, there are a couple of links. These will be made available later on to find out more information. And now, handing it over to the next presenter.
Right. Thanks, Robert, for I think an extremely interesting assessment and also some surprising findings. Next, I hand over to Ari Davidov.
Good morning or afternoon or evening, everybody. I hope you can hear me. This is Ari Davidov from Earth Networks. I wanted to definitely build upon what's been said by the previous presenters and show you an example of the type of work that's being done in conjunction with the NMHS along the lines of early warning systems and public-private partnerships that are intended to sustain them over the long term. Earth Networks, just a couple of quick notes, is a leading weather technologies provider. We are a provider and a partner to NOAA and the National Weather Service here in the United States. We've also over time taken our technology to the global level and have been providing observational systems and forecasting systems to the national governments of middle-income countries such as India, Brazil, and China. And as we were sort of doing that, we really saw that we have a really context-appropriate early warning solution that the developing and really least developed countries in Africa can benefit from in a big way. So over the past several years, we've been working with several development partners and international development agencies to deploy and operate under public-private partnerships these early warning systems in sub-Saharan Africa for the National Hydromet Services. So just to give you some visual context for what it is that we're talking about, this is really modern in that, the types of observations that are being introduced, you, for example, are using compact equipment, sometimes deployed on mobile telecom towers because they're, may not be supporting infrastructure otherwise. Cloud computing is leveraged in a big way as opposed to building big data centers and high-speed computing systems. And information is really delivered into the NMHS and its stakeholders and partner organizations, as well as actually end users through the internet, through interfaces, through web-based displays, through mobile phones and such. Our program is really best thought of in sort of three components. First, like was mentioned earlier, it's really that investment, and in our case, co-investment in the early warning system infrastructure. It's the deployment of these specialized sensor networks for example, for storms and lightning to get that short-term warning and forecast for heavy rains, high winds, hail, and those types of destructive hazards. And then really, once that deployment phase and the training phase is through, guarantee the ongoing operation of this new infrastructure. And that is done as a service level agreement. That is actually a commitment that the private sector partner, in our case, Earth Networks, makes to the NMHS that everything that's been deployed is going to continue operating. And then the long-term view, really the joint go-to-market, this idea that you can resell, you can relicense these software services to the third parties, to paying customers in the country, and do that within a fully legal framework, and do that, and then have a revenue sharing component associated with that to recover the cost for the NMHS as well as the private sector partner. So that's the overall framework of how we approach this. Now, I do want to mention that we focus squarely on the NMHS, and we recognize sort of the mandate of these organizations fully. We engage them at every level. That involves sort of broad-based sensitization to sort of these new concepts and modern approaches to observations, forecasting, and delivery of early warnings. So we do that through engagement at various conferences, workshops. We also bring Africa Med Services here to United States periodically. As we do deploy these observational systems, we focus a lot on training and really the train-a-trainer model of getting getting the folks in the field to understand what is being deployed and how it works and how to operate it on a long-term basis, which they then do in partnership with us. And finally, the end users, it's obviously so important that this information gets used and integrated into the services of the NMHS so that it benefits its stakeholders and the public. A bit about a bit more detail about the actual topic of today's discussion, the PPP. So it really, you can think of it as really having three stakeholders. Of course, the National Hydromet Service, which, in our framework retains, actually gets and retains ownership of everything that gets installed in the country. They also do own the data and really influence the way in which communication delivery systems are designed and implemented. And, they do get quite a bit of training, as mentioned earlier. And that ability for them to share data then really kind of goes over to our part, which is under the Earth Networks bubble here. It's the, first of all, we are the technology provider. So we provide the implementation operation services for the early warning system that we deploy for them. We then get a contractually defined data access and data rights to be able to resell this information. And we then go to market really address the needs of the local industries, which are in the last bubble here. So this is where, for example, insurance companies, aviation, interests, electrical utilities, agriculture, mining, certainly a big one in sub-Saharan Africa, oil and gas, mobile operators, et cetera. They get access to this information and They do that on a paid basis, and then that that revenue share is shared between the public sector partner, the private sector partner within the contractual framework. So that's the overall concept of the PPP that Earth Networks has been driving and implementing in sub-Saharan Africa. We've got a number of projects in really the west, the central, east, and the southern parts of sub-Saharan Africa. You can find more information at the links that are here. I guess I'll leave these up on the screen for you to take a look. And I'm sure that a copy of this will be made available to you as well. Thanks very much for this brief opportunity to share our work.
Thank you very much, Ari. And just to confirm what Ari said, we will be sharing all of the slides following the webinar. So you will have access to the slides and the links for further reading. Thanks a lot, Ari, for sharing some insights into innovative ways of structuring PPPs. Next, I'll hand over to David McAfee to talk about an example of a mobile service that they've been pioneering.
Terrific. Jean-Pierre, can you hear me okay?
I can, and the general feedback from in the chat room is that the sound and the visuals have been very good so far.
Okay, great. Hello, everyone from Washington. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the organizers of this webinar. My name is David McAfee. I'm the Chief Executive Officer of Viamo. We're a social enterprise company based in Washington, D.C., with affiliated offices in 22 countries in Africa and Asia. Our mission is to help organizations working in international development to use technology in innovative, sustainable, and productive ways. And really, the problem that we're trying to address is isolation. Communities are cut off from services and markets and information. Multiple barriers isolate these communities, as you can see on this slide. Everything from low literacy levels to multiple local languages and dialects, poor infrastructure, and great distances. So really, our company, Viamo, we're in the isolation ending business by delivering information that last mile to isolated communities and individuals. So we work hard to establish a two-way communication channel between vulnerable groups and businesses and organizations and government ministries who are trying to help. The reality is that there are now more cell phones in the world than people. And even in Africa, which has lagged behind the rest of the world in terms of cell phone penetration, there are many countries where households are more likely to have a mobile phone than a radio or television. So our goal is to speed up development by maximizing the potential of mobile phone technology. And we've been at this now for about 10 years, but we feel like we're just scratching the surface. So today, I'd like to talk a little bit about our 321 service. It's a free on-demand information service accessible on simple mobile phones. It works like a search engine where there is no internet or very little internet. We use the same technology that you use when you call a toll-free number and hear a pre-recorded message giving you a menu of options. So for example, when you call an airline and hear press 1 for ticketing, press 2 for reservations, we just repurpose that same technology to help break down barriers. So isolated rural people can use their own simple mobile phones to dial a toll-free number anytime, anywhere, listen to a welcome message, and then using their telephone keypad, select and listen to public service informational messages in their own local language. So we first launched the 321 service in Madagascar 8 years ago in collaboration with Airtel, the largest telephone company on the island. And I'm pleased to say that it's still going strong. So today I wanted to share with you the welcome message from the 321 service in Ghana. It says, "Hello and thank you for calling the Vodafone 321 service, a free service that gives you access to useful information. For information on agriculture, press 1. For weather information, press 2. For health, press 3. For education, press 4. So you can see you're not going to get the score from the Manchester United game on the 321 service. It really is dedicated to public service information. And if you're in Ghana and on this webinar, you can try the 321 service yourself by dialing 321 using a Vodafone SIM. So about 2.5 years ago now, in the middle of a terrible drought in Malawi, we added a simple weather forecast to the 321 service in collaboration with the Malawi Meteorological Service. It immediately became the most popular topic on the 321 service by far. And over the past 2 years, we formed a partnership with Earth Networks and the meteorological services across Africa. And now I'm pleased to tell you that our 321 service is connected to Earth Networks forecast. The 321 service automatically updates in multiple local languages every time Earth Networks weather feed is updated, which is about every 15 minutes. After extensive user testing, we greatly simplified the forecast to include only 3 variables: cloudy or sunny, rain or dry, still or high wind conditions. So no temperatures, no numbers at all. And here you can see the current 5-day weather forecast for Tororo, a town in the eastern region of Uganda. So farmers and fishermen call the 321 service and listen to the forecast. And you can see it's a rolling 5-day forecast here. And they have the option of opting in to receive free extreme weather alerts as well. So if you're in Uganda, you can call 161 using an Airtel SIM card to try the service yourself. So we have signed agreements to launch the 321 service with local telephone companies in 16 African and Asian countries. Their total subscriber base is over 100 million people. And we've already launched the 321 service in 13 of these countries. So our proposal to the telephone companies is simple. We provide the content free of charge, and in exchange, the mobile network operators make the content available to their subscribers free of charge. The telephone companies do so because, despite being free to the end user, the 321 by promoting customer loyalty. The 321 service is very popular. To give you an idea, last month in January, there were about 700,000 individuals in 13 countries who called the 321 service a total of 1.8 million times. So in the past 2.5 years or so, more than 800,000 people across 6 countries that you see here on the slides have called and listened to the weather forecast 3.7 million times free of charge. And we plan to make this simple weather forecast and early warning alerts available in 40 African and Asian countries over the next 2 years. The numbers here reflect when the service was made available. You can see in Ghana, Mozambique, Burkina Faso, the relatively small number of callers and calls due to the fact that the weather information was just recently added. I'd like to thank you for participating in today's webinar, and I invite you to get in touch if you have any questions or would like to partner. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, David, for a clear and interesting case study example of a novel business model for presenting a weather service. Next up, I'll be presenting an example of an analysis we did for demand for climate information services at what might be thought of as the opposite end of the spectrum, very long-term information focused on long-term decision-making. I see that the questions are coming in so far for the previous panelists. So our panelists that have spoken, you might have an interest in starting to look at some of the question and answers and preparing some responses to that. Right. So unfortunately, I have two hats to wear today, and I'll have to keep myself to time, or I'll ask Karin to keep me to my 7 to 8 minutes. So South South North, together with Oricon and Pegasus, did a demand and a supply analysis to try and understand what the African demand looks like for climate information services that are integrating climate change considerations into African infrastructure planning and design. This was a project conducted for the World Bank, the African Development Bank, the African Union Commission, and UNECA to inform a facility that they're setting up called the African Climate Resilient Infrastructure Facility. And this was work supported by the UK aid, AFD, KFW, and NDF. I'm just going to share a few high-level responses and interesting findings from our study. Just to set the backdrop a little bit, I think most of our audience members today are aware of the fact that there are many types of long-lived infrastructure that will have lifespans of several decades. And so in the decisions that are being made today in rolling out that infrastructure, not just current climate variability needs to be taken into account, but also future climate change. This is a fairly new field of research, let me just go back one slide. Our survey was trying to understand the nature of the demand for these services along a kind of an infrastructure value chain. So we put out a survey to approximately 800 stakeholders. We received 154 responses from across the African region. And the majority of them were, or the biggest minority were from national governments, but we also had a good sample of private sector, regional political organizations and development banks and other scales of government, with most of our responses coming from Ethiopia, Mozambique and Senegal. So we were trying to understand the demand for climate information services along what might be called a simplified infrastructure value chain. And this, if we had to simplify it linearly, roughly goes from policy and regulation through sectoral planning, the core steps in the project preparation cycle from pre-feasibility to financing, and then on to building, operating, and closure of infrastructure. And we tried to unpack those steps and along the way understand what the entry points are for climate information services. So by way of illustrative example, at the pre-feasibility phase in a particular infrastructure project, there's an opportunity there to provide a service looking at climate risk screening and safeguard systems, climate vulnerability assessments, strategic environmental assessments, and also for the spatial planning of particular infrastructure projects, support to identify vulnerability of specific sites or optimize the siting by evaluating local climate variability and vulnerability. So our responses told an interesting story. Of the responses to the survey, we found that most of them were interested or were working in the policy and regulation environment, as well as the sector and planning environment. With less representation towards the financing, the building and operation side. So our responses might have some biases in how we kind of looked at the nature of demand for these services. I think one of the high level and most interesting findings from our survey was that respondents showed a very clear appetite. Respondents showed a very clear appetite for support to integrate climate considerations into infrastructure. So 88% of the respondents were interested in receiving some support, and we call them ICCPD services for short, which is integration of climate change consideration into planning and design decisions. So 88% showed an interest in these kind of services. About 26% had sought support but had not secured it. And only 20% of our respondents had managed to secure support for this kind of service. There were only 7% that were not aware or unable to specify accurately enough what kind of support they needed. And only 4% of respondents indicated they were not interested in receiving support. So I think a very clear statement that there is demand and unmet demand. Secondly, and also very interestingly, the overwhelming majority of our respondents had examples of actual infrastructure projects that would already benefit from ICCPD services. So these weren't general statements of demand. Examples were provided. So 83% of the respondents told us that they have one or more projects that would benefit from ICCPD support. And the overwhelming majority of them cited projects that were ready for support starting as early as 2017. We tried to disaggregate the type of support that was needed or requested. And when forced to rank some of these services, the following ranking transpired. Most of the respondents were first and foremost interested in climate finance and readiness support, which was also not surprising, but emphasizes again a key finding of the value of and the need for climate finance at bigger scales. Then moving down through training and capacity building support, the development of methodologies and guidelines, provision of data and tools, and at the low end of the spectrum, less of a demand for awareness raising and the development of design codes. I'd like to give one illustrative example of the type of responses we received to the survey. So this was an illustrative example from a development bank with a very project-specific request. A water transfer project being developed in Southern Africa, and a clear statement that, for instance, they would like to receive GCM downscaling, more specific projections of climate impact in the source area for the infrastructure, and analysis and projections of cumulative future water demands within the demand area for the river. So, again, fairly detailed and actionable demands. I can't go through the entire demand analysis with the limited time, but I think there were a number of high-level messages that came out, and that's interesting. One, that there are encouraging trends for supporting longer-term climate information services focused on the infrastructure sector in Africa. Two, there is a market for these services, and it seems to be quite big. And there seems to be a need to prioritize national governments as the project developers for big infrastructure projects and official development assistance as the two biggest sources of funding for many of these infrastructural projects. Awareness raising is key to establish this nascent industry, as we found that many of the respondents that we engaged with had a very low level of understanding of what exactly a climate service might look like. In these industries. Infrastructure project preparation facilities are a key entry point for delivering such services. And it's important that support for existing African climate change and environmental research and technical assistance initiatives should be prioritized as much as possible. I think I've run over time now, so I need to stop myself, and you can see the other recommendations from our analysis on the screen. Right. that brings us to the end of our presentations and our panel discussions. We've had a big increase in the number of questions. I'm going to take a moment with the panelists just to go through the questions before we start posing them to the panelists. If you've not yet submitted your question, please do so now. If you just give us one moment to try, and I'm going to look at if there are any repeat questions and how we can roll these questions together. Right, okay. I see a few questions are directed at Robert. So maybe a good place to start then, kind of from the top, would be, Robert, if I can ask you to answer a handful of the questions, let's say the top three questions that were directed to you.
Thanks, JP. So I can see there's a couple of questions at the front part around some of the sources of information, and then a few other ones around aviation and types of models. So our research was divided into two parts. The first part was a desk analysis of existing peer-reviewed literature as well as gray lit. And the first slide that I showed with the graph came from that existing literature. The second half of our research and findings that I presented was based on case study interviews and additional research with over a dozen different private companies in Africa. And so that was a structured interview with questions to try and understand what their business models are, some of the limitations, opportunities they saw. And so it was a combination of desk research as well as existing literature. There was a question around aviation and also examples of where private sector is providing funding to MET services. So we did look at aviation revenue for the South Africa Weather Service SOARS. So aviation revenue does go to a number of different MET services. It's not always clear on the amounts of it, but it was factored into some additional research I didn't present here due to time limitations around funding and budgeting of MET services that led to some of our conclusions that there needs to be a strong, robust funding for MET service for NMHSs. The aviation sector is another example of where there is funding from private sector essentially going to MET services, but it's through different channels as opposed to a PPP type of arrangement. And there are some that we did identify for, again turning to South Africa, of SOARS and WIS, which was a spin-off private company where there was revenue from the company going into the South Africa Weather Service. Another that we had identified was in Sierra Leone, where there was a platform for CIS information, which is under development. And there was also a revenue sharing where revenue will be going into the MET service. So I will put myself back on mute, JP, if you've had a chance to curate some additional questions.
Yeah. Thanks, Robert. The questions are coming in quite fast at the moment. I think this approach of aggregating questions to particular panelists seems to be working quite well. I know there are several for Ari and David as well that I've seen. So maybe Ari, I hope I'm not putting you on the spot, but if you have had a chance to look at those addressed to you, maybe you want to have a go at answering, again, I would say the top two or three that's been addressed to you. Alternatively, I can also relay them to you.
Sure, and I've actually been sort of busy typing answers as well. You know, so a lot of that's reflected in the text, I think, for the broader audience as well. You know, the questions, you know, really surrounding the model that we are implementing, You know, they're all great. You know, there's quite a bit of them. So maybe I should just sort of make sure that each one's addressed individually, as I'm attempting to do now. So JP, back over to you.
Okay. So just to confirm, Ari, are you're preferring to answer these in writing then by text?
Sure thing.
Okay, great. In that case, I'll hand over to David. David, you can either pick the questions that are addressed to you, or I can relay them to you verbally. And screen, which would you prefer?
That sounds great.
You've got quite a few.
Jean-Pierre, yeah, I've been trying to keep up, much like the other presenters. There was a good question that was asked about what do we do for people who don't have access to the mobile phone network. And I'm just going to share my screen very quickly. The bottom line is that there is no perfect solution out there for a lot of the barrier reasons that I brought up earlier in my presentation. We're talking about vast differences and low population areas where the telephone companies just haven't reached yet. But there is encouraging news there. So I'm going to share this slide that I used recently in a USAID presentation. And mobile phone penetration in Africa is going up by a percentage or two every year. And it will continue to grow primarily because of mobile money services. So the telephone companies believe that they will one day make more money from mobile money services than all of their other services combined, in much the same way that Safaricom has succeeded with M-Pesa in Kenya. But to be able to succeed, they need a robust network that covers virtually the entire country so that people in urban areas can send money to their rural relatives. So telephone companies will continue to invest to push their networks out. Here's an additional piece of information. This was research that was done by the Pew Research Center back in the spring of 2014. So you can imagine 4 years ago, you can see that here about 89% of American adults own cell phones. But there are many countries in Africa who are approaching that same level. So it's true that there simply isn't a magic solution out there to get on-demand information to people at their moment of need, but it's getting better. And the mobile phone offers us sort of another arrow in our quiver to try to reach that last mile into these communities. Because as I mentioned, there are many countries in Africa where it's more likely that even rural households have a telephone than even a radio or a television. And then maybe another issue perhaps to answer in terms of the questions that we got, our service is really targeted at the general population. So farmers and fishermen and really all of us, our target group is basically everybody, all of the subscribers for our particular telephone company partner. As I mentioned, in Uganda, it's Airtel. In Ghana, it's Vodafone. And really the idea is that it's a broad specter, multi-sector, multilingual service that basically makes both static and dynamic information available. So in terms of who our target group is, it's very much targeted at the general population, which is why, especially for the forecasts, after a lot of user testing, it was really important for us to make our forecast as simple as possible to increase understanding.
Thanks, David. I've got a question, one of our earliest questions, which I think is both directed to Ari, David, and Robert. So maybe just a quick, short answer at this. This is Alexander von Hildebrand. He says, there's been a lot of good progress in climate services for agricultural applications, but more is needed in terms of health-related climate services. From your experiences, what have you seen in terms of opportunities for cooperation between MIT services and national ministries of health with the eye on health-focused services? And maybe I'll, Ari, if you'd like to go first on this one, and David and anyone else who wants to chip in can.
Sure, appreciate it. Although, we are a meteorological services company, so there really isn't a whole lot that we do with health. I would like to add that there are now derived variables that are being made available that help identify, potential heat stress and, things like that, that actually are dangerous within the context of agriculture and health. But really, our work is centered around, providing sustainable technology services to the NMHS themselves, who, of course, have a number of stakeholders, among which would be the health ministries. So I'd sort of defer to probably David, that would be most kind of qualified, given his background, to answer these more fully.
Well, yes, thank you, Ari. And it's a great question, because the presenter is absolutely correct. There's a crying need for climate information services in agriculture, but that is extending into the health sector as well, especially as we see the climate changing in Africa. There are these fascinating surveys and research results that show, for instance, that the prevalence of malaria is creeping up the mountains, like Mount Kilimanjaro, and that villages on these mountainsides that had been previously protected are no longer. So the reality of climate change is affecting Africa today, and extreme weather events are becoming more and more common and problematic. But I don't have to tell you guys that, because you're in the business of forecasting and announcing these early warning alerts. But these extreme weather events cause significant public health challenges, from everything from water and sanitation to cutting off access to the public sector clinics. So it's a big problem. And really, the only solution that we've come up with so far is to try to give people the weather forecasts and the opportunity to hear the alerts as early as possible so that they can prepare.
Thanks, David. I have another question that comes slightly more from the research field, and this is particularly focused on the intersection between ongoing research and operationalized service delivery. I think this is a question for all of the panelists, because different perspectives would be quite useful. But I'd like you to comment on, I think, the ethics of delivering many of these services or operationalizing them to large groups of users, when what might be counted as good practice operationally for service delivery over most African contexts is still areas of contested science. And given the uncertainty in a lot of the climate projections and the current state of the science, how do you deal with the ethics of giving wrong or information, essentially? And tied on to that, I think a second question is what we've seen in the scientific community, where there's been a piloting of services that try to bridge the gap between user demands and what the state of the science is. New processes, roughly under the blanket of co-production, that seeks to bring together users and different communities to co-create a certain service that is both consistent with what can be done with the current science and also speaks to certain needs. Have you had any experience in delivering services that are co-produced, and how does that play out in your experience? And we can start, I think, maybe in order of the speakers. I'm not sure if Dimitar has some thoughts on the WMO's framework here for PPE, how that plays out at the policy and framework level, these questions, and then more applied for Robert, Ari and David, how that plays out in practice.
Thank you, Jean-Pierre. I think the communication of the uncertainty and related probabilities and scenarios is a very important part of the service delivery, and this is part of the WMO policy and strategy in service delivery, how to communicate these products for decision making with embedded uncertainty to users, to be very open and clear about the embedded issues and quality. So that's one part of a service and service development. So the how to include this information in the provision of service. And also this requires a lot of communication between the provider and user, and mutual training to identify the needs and the decision-making processes and decision-making mechanisms of the user, and how you can translate and feed appropriate information to the decision-making. And this is all currently one major area of active research development, which is also supported by WMO and its technical programs. So this is, of course, important for public-private engagement framework, because the WMO guidance and standards that reflect these aspects are normally followed by the national by the NMHSs and providers, for example, for aviation information, which may not be NMHSs. When the provider is coming from private sector, we would like to see that the same quality assurance measures apply. So I think I can stop here on this subject.
Thanks, JP. I will chime in on some of these, and then also maybe make a few comments and observations on the health question as well. So I guess on the first one on the ethics, you know, I agree 100% that a certain base level of climate and weather information is a public good. There was a reference in the questions that it's a human right, but there is, you know, unquestionably everybody that we spoke to in the case studies never tried to share an alternate view on that. In terms of how you balance that with, say, a market and other service providers, you know, as the presentations and some of our case studies showed, you know, some of the information is provided essentially for free, and there is embedded uncertainty in different weather information is provided, you know, everywhere in the world. So here, you know, I live in the US as well at the moment. So for example, I can pull up on my phone probably half a dozen different weather apps. Most of them, I'm not even sure if any of them would be using official US Met Service information. I can pull up a whole bunch and then I look at them and see, you know, which one I might want to interpret as being better for the day. But I think, you know, some uncertainty and some diversity is, you know, uncertainty is going to be there anyway, and diversity, I think, is not necessarily a bad thing. On the health question, I think just to a few comments on that. We did look at broader socioeconomic benefits of climate and weather information, and there is a clear net economic benefit to that. You know, one challenge though is that it can be hard to monetize that broader economic benefit. But the next part of the research we're doing under the USAID funded project is to be looking at, or rather working with Met Services to see more broadly who else is benefiting from their services. How can the Met Service reach out to, say, health or other parts of the government funding and the broader donor community to ensure that the information of those other parts of a government, that information they need to be successful on health, on a whole range of other things beyond agriculture. You know, what information do they need? What does that cost? And how do you ensure that there is a broader network of funding? And I will pass it over to Ari next.
Thanks very much, Robert. And a couple of things that I could echo and maybe amplify a little bit. First and foremost, when it comes to sort of this question of what's paid and what's free, there's definitely a way that us and our NMHS partners clearly delineate between those parties that receive information free of charge versus those who pay for it. And within the, so on the sort of the free side, you have your typical government stakeholders, like for example, the National Disaster Management Agencies. But then also you have a number of other ways that information reaches various communities at no cost. And perhaps one private sector, a good private sector example is the 3-2-1 service that David talks about. But we also then, really define a segment of local industries that we can kind of put into the bucket of sustainability partners. And those are, sort of organizations that require specialized solutions that would probably not receive, a very customized, kind of GIS-oriented type solution that responds to their decision support environment. And for that, if that kind of service is made available to them, there's every reason to think that it would be ethical to charge those organizations for those types of solutions. On the part about the issuance of the information and sort of the uncertainty and sometimes the quality of that information. Ultimately, our goal is to increase the capacity of the NMHS to provide, a real-time sort of automated services to their stakeholders, be they paid stakeholders or ones who get information for free. So that's where we essentially kind of stop. But really when it comes to how information is packaged, how it's delivered, really an important role is played by the disaster management agencies at the state level, if it comes to a big country like India, where we do a lot of work at the state level, or, at the national level when it's perhaps an LDC in sub-Saharan Africa. So really that's kind of where the rubber hits the road in terms of, warning information and its dissemination. And that is actually a customer, quote unquote, a customer of the national Met agency, the NMHS, as opposed to, a company like Earth Networks. Those are some of the remarks that I wanted to add to the conversation on those two particular topics.
Thanks, Ari. David, anything finally to add on from your side on issues around the ethics of information provision and experiences in co-producing climate information or weather information with users? And I think we particularly had a few questions that indirectly got to this, that were directed at you, looking at the accuracy of some of the forecasts provided in particular countries.
Well, great. And I think the previous participants articulated the situation very well. At the end of the day, for us, the NMHS is king. And we follow the regulatory requirements and format in each country. So in essence, we're piggybacking on the public-private partnerships that Ari talked about, where Earth Networks builds the capacity of the NMHS to produce these improved forecasts and early warning alerts. And we're simply a new way of delivering that information via simple mobile phones that didn't exist before. So you can sort of think of us almost like an alternative to a radio station or a television station that would typically on the hour perhaps feature the weather forecast that had been generated by the National Met Services. We're just making that information, which is the NMHS's own information, available on mobile phones in sort of a simplified, stripped down version. But we partner with the NMHS's in each country where we work to make sure that they're pleased and encouraged with the service that we provide.
Thanks, David. A quick time check. We've been doing Q&A now for about a half an hour, and we've exhausted our time for this webinar. We've worked our way through about 14 of the questions, and we still have about 42 questions open. I might as well be frank to say we've been surprised by the amount, pleasantly surprised by the amount of demand for this webinar. And the high attendance rates and the number of questions that we've received. And so I think, given I've had a review of all of the questions, they are so wide ranging, that probably the best way to proceed is for the panelists to get together and answer them by text. And all of this will be shared with the registrants and the attendees to the webinar afterwards, in a more consolidated, concise format. So I think with that in mind, I'm not even sure if I'm going to try offer some concluding remarks here. I think we've had a really fantastic initial webinar that has tried to, I guess, give vignettes of different facets of this challenge around understanding demand for weather and climate services in the African region, as well as examples of providing tangible services to meet that demand, ranging on the one hand from the WMO's frameworks and attempts and progress to draw together international collaboration and principles for the provision of these services, through to different models of support for and partnerships between MET agencies, NGOs, private sector service providers, and as well as a nice overview of the market for some of these services, as provided by Robert. So I think for now, I'm going to ask the panelists if they have any closing remarks, if there's any one final thing briefly of 1 minute to highlight. It's not obligatory, but if there's anything big that we've missed that you'd like to highlight now, maybe an opportunity to do that. Before we wrap up the live part of the webinar, and then move on to answering the rest of the questions by text. And again, we'll do that in the order of the presentations.
I would like to thank all the other panelists for extremely interesting presentations that provided practical examples how the public-private partnerships works in concrete environment. All the examples given are very relevant to what WMO is trying to do and what we would like to develop as a guidance material, including the studies of weather market to be more clear about the motivation appetite for services, willingness to pay, and also the models presented by Earth Network and VMO was extremely good. I think there, and I was extremely delighted to hear the statement, the NMHS is a king, because this is actually the answer to what we face. Some perceptions in the public sector that the engagement of private sector may lead to loss of business or loss of visibility or loss of resources. So this is extremely important for the good partnership in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dimitar. Robert, any concluding remarks?
Thanks, JP. I guess something else I wanted to highlight is this piece of work I presented on today is one segment of our work. There'll be another webinar coming up in the coming weeks on another component that ties into ours, and that's looking at how do you assess the sustainability of MET services. And that is from the result of fieldwork plus also a new approach of looking at the global framework on climate services and how a MET agency, where its capacity is with respect to the different components of the GFCS. And the idea behind that is to understand, well, where are the MET services' strengths and weaknesses? And then how are there, what are the opportunities then for strengthening those gaps within a MET service, and where those opportunities might include, for example, partnerships with the private sector, PPPs. And so what we're trying to do through our project is tie together both how do you strengthen the MET service, what's the role of the private sector, and how when you have combinations of MET service plus private sector plus academia to provide an overall more sustainable climate and weather enterprise within Africa more broadly. And so I guess a conclusion on that is that this is part of our research. More work will be coming out that will help flesh out and hopefully get into some of those other questions and issues that have been raised.
Thanks, Robert. Ari, any concluding remarks from your side?
Sure thing, and I'll be very brief. First of all, thank you to everyone in the audience for taking the time to hear our perspectives, and thanks to the organizers and definitely the other members of the panel. I'm really excited that really there is now there seems to be a kind of a convergence of a number of interests and frameworks and approaches coming from all directions, from the international development community, the of course the public sector and the WMO, as well as various private sector players. That's not something that was happening just really two or three years ago. This is very new, and it's very exciting because the whole notion of partnering is really at the core of this, the PPP, right? And that, and the added capacity of all participants in the PPP to do their work and do it sustainably. So from that standpoint, we're very excited to contribute in our own way, and we do contribute to the various WMO processes, the Global Weather Enterprise framework, and certainly all of that at the global level, but really everything is local. And as was said, and I just want to reiterate, our work with the NMHS directly, of course at the senior management level, but then really with the technicians and the forecasters and those who work on disseminating information, that's really important, and that's really where the rubber hits the road. So hopefully a lot more of that will come out of these coming months and years of really a solid global framework developing for doing this kind of work in partnership within the context of multi-user sort of multi-stakeholder type information platforms, which is what we're really about and what we're hoping that this global framework will be about as well. Thank you.
David.
Just, very briefly, because I know we're at time, I'd like to echo Ari's thanks to the organizers, to the participants, to the panelists. I learned a lot. And I just wanted to say that if you're involved with the Climate Information Services, thank you for the hard work that you do, because it's crucially important. Every single person needs to know what the forecast is going to be, and they need to get early warning alerts. So the work that you do is important, and we thank you for it, and we ask you to continue your efforts, because those isolated communities, they need the information, and we need to get it out to them and sort of traverse that last mile. So thank you for the work that you do.
Thank you, David. In wrapping this up, as we are now over time by a few minutes, and in response to some of the final practical housekeeping questions on what the next steps are and what the follow-up is to this webinar, I'll just conclude by saying that everyone that registered for the webinar, we have your contact details, and we'll send a follow-up email to all the registrants. In that email, there'll be links to the presentations, which we'll post on our respective websites. It'll definitely be on the Future Climate for Africa webpage, as well as links to the video. And there will also be a survey in that email where we would like to get your feedback that would help us improve the rest of the series of webinars. So we ask that, please, when we send the follow-up email to you, you'll have access to all the resources, and please also use the opportunity to give us feedback on how we can improve this this forum. So with that, I'm going to bring the webinar to an end. Thank you very much for our panelists, to Robert, Dimitar, Ari, David. Also thank you to Karin and Fatima, who worked very hard behind the scenes to promote the webinar and to handle all the technical side of things. So thank you very much to you and to the team, and thank you very much to our attendees for the very lively discussion. We all hear from us very shortly. Thank you.